Thank you. All right, folks, we are live with the final presentations of Hackout 2021. We've had a grueling almost 40 hours of coding now. And after these 40 hours of coding, we came across some really exciting, really cool hacks. And it became a huge task for the mentors and the judges to shortlist the top 10 from among them. But after much deliberation, we were able to get the top 10 teams. And now we are just going to basically have a demo and presentation by all of these teams, right? I'll just quickly go over the rules for the presentation. So you will get 8 minutes to present whatever slides or demo that you have. When you hit the 7th minute mark, I'll just interject and let you know that you have 1 minute remaining. And then after that, there will be 5 minutes of Q&A by the judges. And we'll basically end this that team session after that and bring on the next team, right? All of our judges are ready. Our first team is ready. So I'll just really quickly introduce our judges. If they could just turn on their cameras and I'll bring them on screen. Awesome, awesome. So basically I'll just bring Pranjal on screen. Pranjal is often called the chief intern officer at Headout simply because he was one of the first interns and then he managed a lot of other interns. How are you, Pranjal? How are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm doing great. Yeah, the title lives by the name.
Yeah, cool. I'll bring on Vikram next. Vikram is the CTO of Headout. He's the brains behind Hackout and has been instrumental in organizing this hackathon. We'll move on to Rachit. Rachit is the engineering VP of engineering at Headout. And we have Tariq and Ravi joining us, who are senior software engineers at Headout. There's Rachit. I'll put Tariq and Ravi on real quickly. There's Tariq. Cool. Awesome. 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 And there's Ravi. Cool. We have our judges panel. We'll be rotating through the judges throughout the stream. And we are already 11 minutes past the start time. So we'll just get right into it. I'll really quickly bring the first team on stage. There's Ishan. Ishan, can you just turn your camera on? And Tanish. I just need both of you to turn your cameras on. Yeah, awesome. Looking sharp, guys. Awesome. So basically, this is team number 10. They were called Team Eva, and they've been building a wearable health device for the elderly. And we're super excited to see what you folks have built, right? I'll just take everyone else off the stage now. And you can share your screen and then we can get started, right?
Is my screen shared?
Yep, it's shared. I'm putting it on. There it is.
Okay, is great.
Anish, if you could just turn your camera on so that you'll be visible.
Yeah, so actually he's on the phone. Yeah.
Yeah, oh, okay. So I'm actually demoing the device, so my camera is vertical. Yeah.
Okay, yes. Not a problem. Cool, guys. I'll just go off now, and your screen is visible. You're ready to go. I'll start the timer as soon as you start. Okay, all the best. See you.
Okay. So should we start? But in a great hackathon experience. So thank you for that. So what we have built, I'll just present the screen. Yep. I hope my screen is visible, right? Yeah. Eva is an affordable wearable device that detects fall and emergency. Coupled with an all-in-one medical health app, it creates a whole ecosystem to care for the elderly. So this is how the device looks. And we specifically 3D printed this whole device for just this hackathon. And this is how you wear it on your wrist. And it detects when the user falls and sends an alarm to the caretaker of the specific elderly to take immediate actions when the patient falls. Now let's talk about why we chose this problem to solve, right? So there are more than 37 million people who get medically affected by falling. And this increases as we go to the older age. Because when you hit 60, your bones start getting weaker and you're more prone to actually falling. And if a problem affects 37 million people in the world, I believe it's a huge problem to solve, right? So, and thankfully, it's being solved by this product, Apple Watch. We all know this, right? An Apple Watch detects the fall, and this specific fall detection technology has helped millions of people worldwide to live a healthy life. And as you can see on the screen, there are countless and numerous instances where people have like actually saved their life because of this basically fall detection technology. But what we believe is that a healthy life should be right of every person on this planet and not just the rich. What we are trying to do here is to democratize healthcare for everyone. Basically, we believe that having a good and healthy life should not be just be limited to the people who can afford a $400 watch, which is like Apple Watch, right? But a good and healthy life should be accessible to every person on this planet, irrespective of their economic status. Introducing EVA, an $8 wearable device to help everyone live a long life. Yes, just $8. Now I'll just show you some videos which we have created while developing the hardware device. So now before moving on, this is the internal parts of the device. These are the basically the chips and the Wi-Fi modules and the specific accelerometer and gyroscope which we have used. And on the other side, it's the basically lithium-ion polymer battery, which actually gives 1 month battery life, on opposed to Apple's watch 1 day battery life. And now specifically this 3D printing process, which we 3D printed the whole case on our own self. So this was the process. Now jumping on directly to the demo, because I know you would be guys excited about it. So can Tanish share the?
Yep, I've downloaded my camera.
Perfect. So Tanish will be showing the device and I'll be showing the app and how it actually, the flows works. So Tanish, can you show the device? Yeah. He's plugging the battery and now he'll fit it into the device case.
So this is the case that we 3D printed.
Yep. So this is the app and that is basically the device, and these are both are connected. So what actually happens is that when a user falls, that the device sends a signal onto the database, and the database alerts the app specifically that the user has fallen. So let's see the app.
I'll jerk the device. That will so accelerometer, the 3-axis accelerometer 6050 will detect an impulse, and it will update the value on the front end. So
this is the app and this is the device active. Yes, you can see that when gave a hard jerk, the value here on the database went to of the fall value went to 10 to true, and on the app you can see the fall is detected. So the caretaker can take the immediate measures what all he or she have to take. Now we'll demonstrate it once again. Tanish, can you do it default?
I'll reset.
Yeah. Okay. So the device is reset, and the device, you can see the device is active. Perfect. So now
I'll jerk it again.
Yep. Yeah. Exactly. So this is how it works. When the user jerks, it automatically gives a detection onto the app to the caretaker to basically send the help or whatever the measures are to be taken. So this is the app. That was a hardware device. I'll show you the app once again.
One more thing about hardware device. Basic implementation, it has ESP8266 as a microcontroller that has a Wi-Fi built in to connect to the internet and ultimately to the Fire Store. And then, as I said, the fall is detected by sudden impulse through a 3-axis accelerometer on MPU6050. And there's also a battery charging discharging circuit, which also manages overcharging and overcurrent protection. And plus there is a $2 lithium ion cell, 1865, 1850. This orange thing you can see is the battery, and this is the electronics. That blue part is accelerometer, and this part, the steel one, enclosed RF enclosure. This is the microcontroller enabled that has Wi-Fi enabled, and this is the charging and discharging circuit. So the total cost, even if we bought everything from the retail, was around $8. So yeah, Ishan will take over from here.
Yeah. So that was the hardware. Now onto the app, which is like a whole ecosystem of like medical, taking the medical care for the person. So this is the beautiful home screen where you are greeted. So let's start by clicking the Get Started button. We are now directly taken onto the home screen where you can see the names of the elderly, which you are taking care of, right? And the device status, that the device is active or the device is inactive, right? So let's look on to the Rakesh Goel's profile, the patient details. And here we can see there are all the details, that blood group, age, sex, their name, health insurance, and like the are they diabetic or not, the current medication, the side effects of the current medication, and all these details are very important, because like in a crucial time, like in an emergency, a single minute could make a life and death difference, right? And in the situation, these details, that if are they diabetic or what's the blood group or the current medication and their side effects, the side effects of the current medication would be like super beneficial for the basically giving the treatment and medications. So that's what we have built, the whole ecosystem of the hardware plus software. And what we try to do is to democratize health to everyone and not just the rich. And we think that it could like make the world a better place with this. So thank you. And any questions?
Amazing. That was a great presentation, Ishan and Tanishq. I'll just put all of our judges on stage. In case they want to ask any questions,
I'll start with questions. Is all the 3D print, has all the 3D printing been done in the hackathon?
Yeah. So like Danish has a 3D printer at his home, so he has done all 3D printing.
All right, cool. I'm assuming you will always have to wear this device, right?
Yeah.
So how would you go ahead and decrease the size of the device?
Yeah. So as you can see, it's like a little bit bigger because obviously we have done this hackathon in 48 hours, right? So what we are, So the Apple Watch, you can see as I'm wearing the Apple Watch, the basically battery is like 1 day. And what we have used in that is a lithium polymer ion battery, which has a 1 month battery life. What we can do if we want to reduce the size is we can like take the battery and like reduce that 1 month battery to one day, and it could like potentially like significantly shrink the size. It could be somewhat like an MI band, which you can say a very pretty small, which you can wear and it won't be like hamper your day-to-day task. And this was a prototype which you done in like this like time frame. So yeah, that's why it's like a little bit big.
Got it. And if a person falls, then to whom all is this notified?
Yeah, so basically let's suppose my father is elderly, right? And so I will set up the device for him, and when basically the device detects a fall, the notification would be sent to my phone, right? Or let's suppose there is an old age home, so a nurse is have the app, and the nurse can actually all the elderly can have the watch onto their hand, and the nurse can in a single app and have all the information of all the people, and then can detect specifically, right? And on the third, in a hospital, nurses can have like for the patients. These are the like few use cases where you can like have the caretaker app.
Got it. What if someone forgets to turn off the device?
Yeah.
And then takes the device off and then, you know, just puts it somewhere.
Yeah, so basically like what we do is that like, obviously we takes the like, basically we have done a specific few trials that it's on the hand on specific or not, right? And talking about that, basically if someone has turned on, you can always like turn it off from the device itself.
What if they forget to turn it off?
Yeah, so like it will give, so basically like let's suppose you get the notification and you will probably try to contact, right? And what we can do right now, we do not have a buzzer in it, but we can also like add a small little bit of small sound which can take a like which when it falls, it can give somewhat sounds in it. So it like tells that, okay, it's like beeping. So you have to turn it off, or if you are okay. And if you're not okay, like you can like keep it continuing.
No, but that still doesn't solve the problem. The problem is that you didn't turn off the device and you jerk put it somewhere. And the notifications end to the hospitals and ambulances are coming to your place.
Okay, so it directly does not send to the hospital. It firstly sent to one of your emergency contact which you have set up, and they can actually like call you specifically, like contact you for that specific reason, or like they can come over like specifically. And that's the first thing. Secondly, what we have done is that what we can do, we have not done specifically, you can add a buzzer in it. So like when you keep it would start beeping. When it's
in the house. No, I don't think so. Buzzer is the right thing. That doesn't really solve it. But I do think like a proximity sensor can solve this problem.
Proximity sensor to.
Yes.
Yeah. I am. So like what we are thinking
about. Like a proximity sensor, which works with bio stuff and doesn't work with non-bio stuff. I think that can happen. Okay.
Not just a proximity sensor, a capacitive some some sort of capacitive
made proximity sensor.
We can possibly add a very affordable IR sensor or air reflector that detects the proximity or if the patient has worn the device or not. So it's a basically very cheap addition, but a very valid point. And we'll if we go in future to work on more on the device, we'll particularly focus more on the stuff to eliminate that particular problem that we are facing, a problem of the device turned on even if it is not worn by anyone. So we'll work on.
Yeah.
So right now it does not support that functionality, or it does not solve that particular problem.
Yeah, but like that's what like we built in 24 hours at the whole ecosystem. So maybe, yeah.
Cool.
Any other questions?
I guess that's all the questions that our judges have for you folks. Great presentation.
Sorry. I'm really sorry. I had a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, how do you ensure that if somebody is sick, if somebody is moving around, they can give give that jerk, right? Like if I'm walking briskly, or if I'm just, if I just try to jump, that can also give that jerk.
Yeah,
right?
I get your point. Yeah. So this specific device is specially designed for elderly, right? So. Let's suppose like our young people, when you set up your Apple Watch, it is automatically turned off for the specific certain range of age, because you like we do gymming and we do like specific activity stuff that could potentially turn on the specific fall detection. So what this is designed specifically for and trained on is that how much elderly, how much like people above 60 years move, and their movement is relatively low than compared to a 20-year-old person. So that's why we like use that, and specifically also we use that the X, Y, and Z coordinates. That are you just jumping, or are you actually falling? And we are like we have done that specifically trials and that, and that's why and the basically the accuracy is done specifically on that only. So the question we have like had that accuracy in this device.
Got it, and it ignores all the say if you turn your wrist and all those things are ignored.
Yeah. And again, like it's specifically for not for like young adults, but for the elderly people. And the elderly, the people who are like above 60, above 70, above 80, their movements are relatively low in overall, right? So you can actually track what is actually a jump or what is actually a fall.
Got it.
Yep.
I think somebody asked a similar type of question in the chat.
Okay. Yeah. So this is the same answer that like elderly people.
Cool. Great presentation, guys.
Thank you so much.
Cool. Any other questions from our judges? Cool then. In that case, Ishan, Tanish, thanks a lot for joining us. I'll take you folks off now.
Thank you so much.
Cool. And I'll put myself on now. Right. Yeah. So that was a great first presentation. We'll quickly bring our second team on board. This is team number 14, and they go by the name of HTML Hack NASA, which is quite a quirky name. They're building a project which is a crypto-based fantasy sports platform where users can play fantasy sports and earn crypto rewards, which sounds really exciting. Let me just see if they are in already. Yeah, they're just joining. In the meanwhile, I'll just quickly point out that it was really awesome to see a hardware come software hack being built in an offline hackathon. Wasn't really expecting a lot of hardware hacks. And the fact that they were able to 3D print everything at home was pretty awesome. Anyway, Amit and Hardik from Team 14 HTML Hack NASA are here. Hey, Hardik, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Amit, can you just turn your camera on, please, so that we can see you?
I believe Lavish must be there instead of Amit.
Manish is also here. I'll put him on as well.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, Lavish is also here. Okay, awesome. All of you folks are here. Cool folks. I'll really quickly drop off now. If you could just share your screen, I'll put it on stage. Yeah, I've done that. Cool. I'll drop off now. Over to you. I'll start the timer whenever your folks are ready.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. I'm audible, right?
Yeah.
So good evening, everyone. We are the team HTML Hacks NASA, and we are a team of 4 people. Me, that is Lavish Tatid, Manish Motwani, Hardik Khan Chandani sir, and Amit Harpal sir. So we are delighted to present our application, that is Cream 11. Basically, it is a platform. It is a fantasy platform where you can earn money by betting over the real sport games. It is inspired from Dream 11, and it has crypto, blockchain, and crypto in it. So we have named it as Crypto plus Dream 11, that is Cream 11. And now talking about this application. In this application, you can do real world crypto transaction from which you can bet. You can bet in upon the statistic of real sports. We will show our website, and it is a hybrid website which is really mobile friendly also. And just a second, let's come to the introduction part. So as I have already tell you that Cream 11 is a crypto based fantasy sport where you can play different sports, and you can predict the score and statistic of the score, and upon betting on those scores you can earn cryptocurrencies.
One minute, Lavish. Yes. I would say rather than betting, it is a more skill based based platform, just like a Dream 11. I mean, if you see cricket, and if you know the players well, who will perform well, and which players can do well, then it is more of a skill based, just like a Dream 11. Yeah. Lavish, you can continue.
So let's observe the problem in Dream 11 as of now. So from the perspective of current user, they see no problem. But we will tell you the problem that right now Dream 11 is facing and that we have come up with. So as of now, Dream 11 is a centralized app, and what we have created is a decentralized app. So let me tell you the difference. When you're using a centralized app, user, you know, there can be a kind of trust issues, because users are also losing their money. So they have to be, a fully trusted system. But when you use a centralized system, there are chances of failures. There are chances that servers can be down, and also when it comes to transaction part, credit card and bank details, these are some sort of vulnerable as compared to cryptocurrencies, because in the blockchain everything is transparent, every block can be seen, and it creates a really trustful environment for users. And the most important thing is the data cannot be mutated in our application.
Lavish, I will put a point here.
Yes.
The main important is mutation. So if you are a developer at Dream 11, or if you have some access of database in Dream 11, you can actually earn in crores just by mutating the data. So this is the main major point in the centralized system. So that is why where decentralized system plays a major role in this. So modern problems requires modern solutions. So the solution is really simple, and but really hectic for us to implement, because we all are new to blockchain. The whole team is new to blockchain, but still we were able to implement most of it. There are some benefits of our decentralized system, as we all know what are the benefits, but there are special benefits in sports fantasy game. First of all, it is actually a real time. Everything is happening in real time, and actually one of the most reason is we don't know the pool, who is a pool base, who the users are, and who are participating in this, and this is also a major issue. Also,
folks, sorry to interject, but I would suggest that you should jump into your demo because 4.5 minutes have already passed. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm sharing screen. Okay, so here, just like you have seen, there can be a multiple upcoming matches or there can be a live matches. So you can join any match where do you want to play. And here you can create a team. You can you can select few players from England and few players from India. So that you have, there are some rules that you have to choose at least 11 players. So here I have created a team of 11. So first of all, I need to connect my MetaMask wallet. Now, to join into the team, to create a team, I have to pay the entry fees, right? Just like we do in Dream 11. We pay somewhat like 15 rupees in entry fees. So here you can pay the entry fees, and here you will you will be able to see the dashboards, leaderboard, and the amount of bid you have put into. And we were about to show the live match data here, but we could not use the real time API, so that is why it is empty. Also, a user can see his earnings in this a great UI and he can see his past earnings and as well. So yeah, so this is what we were able to make. Lavish,
yeah. So this was all that we have tried to make in this 2 days. We were actually totally new and new to the to these technology, and we have learned everything in these 2 days only. And everything that we have developed is totally new to us. And talking about the future scope, in the future we are planning to integrate more such things like Bitcoin, and user can use. We will have wallets where user can use any kind of cryptocurrency to you know, to play these game, and there are a lot main things like a lot of algorithms and that are need to be updated in the future aspects.
Yeah, actually currently we have implement a not very good Solidity contract. Also, we are currently serving from a local blockchain network. So just for the testing purpose, we are using Ganesh for that. Also, one more thing we can we will love to implement in future, that there can be an issue in data also. Let's say in real time data also. So we can also shift that real time data to the block. And let's say the Virat hits a six, and so we are to make sure that we are getting a trustable and secure data also. This is only a point where user can little bit do an untrust, but that thing also is open. We all know that the live data, what's currently happening in the match, so that was not a major issue, so we were not able to implement it.
Mm-hmm. Cool, folks, we are running out of time. If there's anything that you want to say in wrapping it up, let's do that. Otherwise, we'll jump to the...
Yes, we can also show the mobile version of it, if possible.
Sure, let's do that real quickly.
This one, Lavish?
Yes.
Okay. Nice one.
And the profile part also.
Please refresh the place, the page after it being in the mobile UI part, so that we can, because I think you made it responsible. It's not really coming up.
Sorry, I don't know about you.
I was saying, can you just open the, like, you've made it in a responsive way, right?
Yes, exactly.
The right now I could see things, this overlapping thing. Is this because you're resizing, or will it fix if you reload the page after you turn on the mobile thing?
Yeah, that's one button, that's connect. I think that's overflowing.
Okay, leave it.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Yes.
Cool. I would like to go on with some questions. Cool. You did talk about that whole on-chain data coming up on-chain. Data needs to come up on-chain, otherwise your smart contracts won't execute. We had also talked about it separately during the mentor sessions and stuff. How would you do that?
Can you repeat? Sorry, I'm not getting
how would you trustlessly port cricketers' data, live match data, on chain?
One thing we can do is we can keep track of data. There can be a block, and that block can keep track of the data of a current match.
How does it do that? Yeah. Your blockchain networks can't really talk to the outside world.
One thing we can do is we need to, okay, so that is a complicated thing. We need to have our own server which keeps
rotating. Your server could put in wrong data and my money will go off.
Yeah.
I mean, the centralization problem comes again, right?
Yeah, but the thing is, we can use external APIs also, like Rigbus and things like that.
External APIs where, like, in your server, which updates data to blockchain? What if your server is corrupt? Like, it's who trusts that?
No, actually, currently we do not have a match details on block. We currently have a block of users, what user has chosen, what the rules of games. So currently these things were important to keep into the block. So currently we have kept them into the block. So the data of the live match can we get it from the API like Rigbus.
So like when you are distributing rewards according to, you know, the team selected or whatnot, you are manually triggering it, like, you know, okay, the decision is declared in this fashion. Then there is a, like, if someone is doing it, then that someone cannot be trusted, right? There's a trust issue. There's a core trust issue there.
Yeah.
So like that's what the question was, like how, like if you solve it, like, obviously you're not solving it in this hackathon. You haven't solved it in this hackathon, but when you do, like how will you do it?
So we can add these checks on contract. Let's say even if untrusted person is trying to, let's say, finish a match, let's say it is a calling of method on the smart contract, we can add a check on contract that only an authentic person is doing it. Or
yeah, but the thing is that you are trusting the authentic person. That is the whole problem. That is the centralization problem. That is still not being solved. I can't really trust someone to put in the right data and have my money be at the mercy of that data. Because someone could really put some wrong data so that they could benefit out of it and then just get lost. Right? So that is a very, very core problem that needs to be solved. Until and unless that problem is not solved, this thing won't work. Look into Oracle problems. Look into how Oracles work. That is the direction that you will have to take. Second question, you still haven't implemented the betting money going in, right?
Yeah, I implemented the entry fees of 0.1 ETH, if you have seen.
Okay, so you that entry fees was not the gas fees, that was like a pure entry fees.
Yes.
Yes.
Cool. You also talked about integrating Bitcoin. How would you do that?
Lavish. So as of now, we have worked with Ethereum, and you know, as we have told earlier that we are new to this technology and we don't know much. But I have seen some blogs and posts that that tell about how you can integrate, you know, other coins, you know, all the altcoin or maybe shitcoin, then every coin that that exists.
Yeah.
So
you use shitcoins.
So basically, there are some kind of documentation also. We haven't, as of now, read them, but shortly after reading them, we can implement those things.
Okay, cool.
Maybe he's trying to tell about swap. Swapping.
I'm sure. But cool. That's it from my
end. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for guiding us, sir.
Not a problem. Always.
And we'll surely apply all the changes that you told us.
Cool. Awesome, folks. Thanks for that amazing presentation. I'll take you folks off now. Cool. While we get our next theme on board. Folks, could you just click on the leave button on the top right of your screen? It'll take time for me to like remove all of you one by one. Yeah. Thank you. Cool. Let's get our next team on stage, Sumesh. They're joining. While they join, I'll just give a quick intro. So basically, this next team is Team 15, legacy team. And they're actually building a project which allows developers or technical content creators to write blogs and then cross-post them on various blogging websites. Apart from that, they're also building a project that helps sync GitHub repositories with Notion. And so you can have a Notion Kanban board for all of your open issues and pull requests and all of those things. I'll bring them on stage and I'll let them talk about it because, yeah, they're here. Hey, Sayam, how are you? Hey, Uzair.
Hello.
Hey, folks. Hey. So, cool. If you could just share your screen, I'll put it on stage, and we can get underway. Just a quick advice. You should try to jump into your demos as quickly as possible, right?
Okay. Fine.
Yeah. Just do a quick intro of the project, of the idea, and then jump into the demos.
So I'll present my screen.
Yeah, I've put it on stage. I'll drop off now. All the best, folks.
Okay. So. Without wasting any time, I'll directly start with what is integrateme.co. So the project which we built goes by the name of integrateme.co, and it helps you integrate various different services using their APIs. So the problem statement was, if you are a technical blogger, you must have felt the need to cross-post your blogs between dev.to, Medium, and Hashnote. These are the primarily basic dominating platforms of content blogging, technical content blogging to be precise. And if you simply go on copying, pasting your long blog post, it will be a tedious task. And moreover, if you have code snippets of blog embedded in it, so you can't really do it without having extra pain, because some uses Markdown as a way to store their data. Some have their custom format, et cetera, et cetera. So those code blocks do not get embedded properly. And so yes, to solve that, we built something to cross post your blogs between all these three platforms using a single click. And if you are a productivity lover like me, so you must have come across this tool called Notion. It is a very powerful tool. You can use it to demonstrate PPTs. Like it's a very powerful tool. So we have planned to build. It is a go-to software for your daily dev workflow. So currently, the tech stack which we used is Django and Express.js. There are a microservice architecture which we are following. So one of the server is based in Django, other is in Express.js, and front end is in React. So the backend architecture is something like this. For dev.to and Hashnote post, it's just like the core problem which we faced is every these three platforms, DevDot2, Medium, and Hashnote, have their own way, own JSON structure. Like some called a title of blog post as title only, and some called it name. So to counter this, we converted all the content into a mutually understandable JSON structure, this one, and then post it. So another problem is which we faced was Medium does not have an API to fetch content of a page. It does have an API to post content, but doesn't have to fetch content. So for this, we converted, we fetched the RSS feed for that page and then converted it into JSON, then to a mutually understandable JSON structure, and then post a thing. Now, coming on to the backend structure for that GitHub Notion issue sync. Every Notion page has something called as a page ID, which we save in a while after going through Notion's OAuth, and it generates a unique UUID. UUID, and then gives a unique URL. Then we just have to set this URL to listen to webhooks from GitHub so that we are notified about the events. Firstly, the problem we faced was like this unique UID part wasn't existing before. So like every request for all the users were coming in a single endpoint. So like to counter this, I've gone through this approach to generate a unique UID so that and every repository will have a unique endpoint and it will listen for webhooks for. So like now let's jump on to the demo. So this is our website. This is the front end. We'll have to go through authentication at the first, but as I'm already logged in, I'll skip it and directly go on to cross posting. Just a second. So we'll post from dev.2 to Medium on Hashnote, I'll just grab a random post from dev.2. Load balancer 101, this is a blog post of mine. Now we have to give a Medium API and a Hashnote API. I've already copied it over here. Oops, I believe I stopped sharing my screen by mistake.
Not a problem. Share it again. I'll put it on. Yeah, your screen is visible now. You can go ahead.
Currently, you can see all my stories. There are no drafts in my Medium account, as well as in my Hashnote account. So I'll just go ahead and cross-post it. Fine. This post should be cross-posted everywhere now. Successful. Just have to refresh it. See over here also. The same load balancer post has been cross posted everywhere and on Hashnote also. We're fine. That's it for the first integration. Now let's move on to the second one, which is syncing our GitHub issues with Notion. So firstly, we have to replicate a template, which will be provided on the front end itself later on, which is this one. And I've already did it. So I'll just quickly go on authorizing. This will give us a unique URL, which I've showed in the backend architecture as well. Now, for the repository which we want to sync, let's go over there. And in the, we have to set a webhook for it and give that URL as a payload.
Folks, you have 1 minute left. Let's try to wrap things up.
Fine. Yes, yes. Now it should be start working. As soon as I create an issue on GitHub, it will be created on a card over here as well.
Does it not sync existing issues?
Yes, sir. It was on card to sync existing issues, but due to time constraint, I wasn't able to do that. So as soon as I created an issue, it got a card in open issue, and as soon as I close it, it will be moved in the closed issue section. See, that's it. That's the both the integration, and we have a lot of future plans. Integration planned, like a Google Classroom Todoist and Notion. As soon as our teacher assigns us assignment in Google Classroom, it will be made available in Todoist, Notion, and this one we have completed. Then we can just write in Notion and publish in Medium, Hashnode, and Dev.2 also, and sending email using Notion for marketings and newsletter email. You can just write in Notion and send it to all the platforms available. Like, you can take a look at all the future planned integrations. That's it, sir. Any questions?
I actually don't have any questions. That much questions. Like, it was a good presentation.
Yeah, I do have a question. Just a quick one. So. Yeah. So basically, Uzair, Sayam, if you remember, we discussed this during the final review as well. Were you folks able to solve the problem where basically right now anyone can take a link to a blog that doesn't belong to them, right? And then they can use the tool to post it from their account on various platforms. How are we solving for that?
Yes, sir. Actually, that issue gets solved by the platform itself. If you cross post a blog from someone else, it will be already flagged as plagiarism, and it will be deleted, as well as your account will be suspended. But that
should be a second level check, right?
Okay.
The first level check should happen.
So we could implement, instead of like going through the giving the link of the post, we can implement OAuth and let users select the post from their account which they want to publish.
Right. Yeah,
we could also have definitely another system at play where for the post given we could check the author, and since we already have the token IDs, we can compare it.
Yeah,
and yeah, it always has a unique ID, and so if it doesn't match, we can surely give them a warning that it's not the case, that it's their post, and similarly work accordingly to that.
Yeah, exactly.
That's also a viable solution,
because using the platforms as a means of check is not really a good idea, because the post will be up for a couple of days, right, before it gets taken down.
Definitely.
Yeah, but in any case, I mean, honestly, like, I feel like the tool solving it, like, it's a bit of a far cry. But yeah, never mind. Like, if you can, you should. So that's another thing. My question here is, like, how are you exactly porting contents across, like, platforms? Like, what are you exactly doing to basically map the current content format, let's say the code format, from one to other platform? Like, how are you doing it exactly?
You must be talking about this mutually understandable JSON structure.
Yeah. So basically, yeah. So like, you, like how you extract the contents out of, current, from Medium, if I'm moving from Medium to Hashnode, then what exactly, like how are you extracting content, and like how, what sort of transformations are you applying so that it becomes compatible with other formats for other.
So, sir, whenever you give a URL to your post, we use that respective platform's API to fetch the content, and then then we convert it into a mutually understandable JSON structure, which can be later used to to another platforms using their API keys.
Okay, and let's say there are some sort of media types which are kind of supported by one platform but not by other ones.
Okay, for that, the content is scrapped in an HTML format. This was the issue we faced. Initially, we used a Markdown format, but the issue you just mentioned, like one of the URLs, videos to URLs are support, URL videos are supported in HTML but not in Markdown. So instead of using Markdown, we scrapped the HTML content and used it to post everywhere. So HTML content didn't bother much.
Okay, cool. That's all the questions that I had.
We're fine.
I wanted to actually go ahead and ask, first of all, like we like your the whole project completeness, the whole thing and stuff. So kudos to that. I wanted to understand, and this might be a silly question. When something is being synced to Notion, Notion has a lot of page hierarchies, right? So
how is it
dictated as to where this content goes?
Okay, so sir, whenever a user authorized, firstly you have to use our specific template which we have just shown over here. Like I think I've closed it. So you have to use a specific template. So whenever a user authorized that page, we save that particular page ID into our database, and later we have three columns in it. So whenever an issue with an action opened is shot at our syncing URL, we creates a new page in the open issue column, and wherever whenever that issue is closed, we move it to the closed column. I hope I'm able to explain you.
Sir, actually the hierarchy of the pages is already handled by Notion's OAuth, as it gives you the option to select the page from where you want to sync your GitHub. So that is sorted at that point itself.
Got it. And got it. From there you can start, and then you can figure out what hierarchy you want for that information.
Exactly.
Yes, sir. Any more questions?
I guess that's all the questions that our judges have for you folks. Great presentation, guys. We'll catch you later. I'll take you off now.
Thank you.
Uzair, Sam, just click the leave button on the top right corner of the screen. Yeah. Cool. That was a great presentation. I'll quickly bring the next team on board. And while I bring them, I'll just introduce them. They're team number one, the Merkle boys. And there they are. Samir, Shikhar, can you just turn your cameras on, please? There's Samir. Hey, Samir, how are you, man?
Yeah, hi. I think Shikhar is having some network issues. Not sure if he'll be able to.
Okay. Not a problem. He's here. Cool. So basically, the Merkle boys have built a Tezos wallet on using Flutter, and I'm really excited to see this project. You folks can just share your screen. I'll put it on, and then you can take it away.
Just a minute. Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible. I've put it on. Cool. Okay. All the best, folks.
Thank you. So quick intro, I'm Samir from Bangalore. My teammate is Shrikar. And we decided to build a Tezos wallet app, which was one of the track prizes. So I've been recently diving a lot into blockchain over the past couple of months, and I saw Tezos like last week, and I thought it would be a great way to explore through this hackathon. So quick presentation. So the first thing is the definition. So like Tezos is a blockchain. It has some key features like I think it updates the governance models, just updates automatically or something. So I'm still researching a lot about Tezos, but yeah, I learned quite a bit through this hack. So we named it Anthos because it rhymes with Tezos. And let me show you the features and what future possibilities it has. And I can dive into the demo. So the current features we have implemented, which was over the past 1.5 days, was a way to easily send and receive Tezos, which was just transactions. And then since it is built on Flutter, it is not optimized for the web yet, but we could essentially run it on web. Just the sizing would differ and desktop. So that is one great advantage I saw that Tezos is pushing towards using Flutter, I guess. And then we are not yet using it, but we are using a secure wallet, secure storage, which uses AES encryption, a package in Flutter, which we are using it in some places to store the keys and everything. And then we also thought of adding a live tracker of Tezos price so that people can also easily track what the actual value of their wallet holds in terms of dollars. And then, yeah, there were a lot of possibilities. As we went through the project, we kept discovering newer ones and some things we couldn't implement due to time constraints. So first one was a local password screen, just like how you get on payment apps. And then currently I'm only supporting testnet, but it's I just have to integrate that part of mainnet and other test networks. And then I wanted to also show a pretty graph of the market cap and everything, but I couldn't implement that much. So I'm just showing information right now from the API. And then more good possibilities would be, I think deep linking would help other dApps connect to this particular wallet. And then storing collectibles and NFTs will also make this project a really good one. And then other advanced features like swapping tokens. And I think Tezos has some other concepts which I haven't dived into yet. So some things like fundraiser accounts and delegation and validation. So these are some of the other things that we plan to integrate hopefully in the future. And so these are just screenshots. So I'll just dive into the demo. Not sure if my I'll just show my phone's entire screen.
Yeah, it's live now.
Yeah, it looks like my I think you can see my phone right now. So this is the home screen, and we can either create a new account or import an existing account using a mnemonic key. We also have to add support for importing it through a private key. So currently I'll just go through first the import account so that I have a funded wallet, and then I'll show you create a new account. So this is my current wallet. I've done some transactions on it, and you can see I have, this is on the Grana testnet, and it's showing the current price in Mutes and Tezos and in dollars. So I also have implemented this card, which shows some details, which I'm getting from the CoinGecko API, which is a free API. So yeah, I should probably show this in a more prettier way. That was the goal. And second thing is, I think these are the transactions, and you can also tapping on that shows the entire transaction details of it, all the things, like the gas used, the gas limit, timestamp, sent to, transaction as block hash, and everything. So this is the received one, and this is the sent one. And there also, I think this is the first operation that Tezos performs when you create a transaction. So that was a reveal operation. So that I'm accounting for that as well. And then this is a receive screen where I have created a QR code, and you can just tap to copy also. And then we also have the scanner, but due to some dependency issues, I couldn't completely implement it. And then we also have a settings page. Even these are a bit incomplete, but the resetting the wallet works, so I can delete all of the information from the phone and then put a new account on there. And then let me do a transaction now. I think I have my other wallet open in this browser, which is a Temple wallet. So let me just send to this, I guess, first. Though I'm not sure if I... Maybe. So I'll just send some tokens to this wallet first and then send it back. I think it's not confirmed yet. Okay. Yeah, you can see it has reflected here that plus the 1 million meters, which is basically 1 Tezos. So it also shows the address of where it came from, which is the wallet account. And then let me just send it back to that previous wallet. No. I can copy the address from here. Send, paste it here. So I'm also planning to implement, just cache the recently used addresses, which also couldn't implement due to time constraints, but just as an Acer UX experience. And then even this, so I'll just send back one Tezos back to the wallet. So send. I think unlike the wallet, I'm not sure. I haven't researched if we can have options to make the transaction faster and slower and everything. So let me just refresh this and see if it has come. I think it takes a few seconds. For the API to index the transaction and then receive it. Yeah, now it's reflecting. So yeah, the transaction that I sent has gone through. I think it should show here as well. I think it'll be less than 100 because of the gas fee. Or yeah, it's 100. Yeah. So yeah, that was pretty much it. I guess now right now it's a basic wallet, but I do see a lot of possibilities and hopefully we'll get to make this a good open source project. That is what I'm aiming for. And it was great learning Tezos in a short time. And there was a lot to explore and I really got some great insight and it was a great hackathon. So thank you guys. That's it from my side.
All right, thank you folks. As usual, I'll go first with questions. Why Tezos?
I have worked on, over the past couple of months, I've worked on Polygon, Ethereum, Celo and Solana. So Tezos was one more big blockchain that I hadn't checked out. And I saw some other things in it. I think Tezos India community is also growing a lot. I saw a lot of posts on LinkedIn. And also I wanted to check it out. And then they also had a nice hack prize on the hackathon. So I thought this would be a good shot to try. And I have been doing Flutter for like 2 years now. So it was a very sweet deal for me.
Got it. There are so many wallets already out there, right? So why build another wallet? What is so special about this wallet?
Yeah, basically I'm thinking the main motivation is the cross-platform ability. I think that we can maintain one code base and because of Flutter, we can have it run on multiple platforms.
When you say multiple platforms, do you mean multiple chains?
No, like desktop, web, and mobile in the single code base.
There are many wallets that do that. There are already many wallets that are cross-platform from a client side perspective.
I mean, like with a single code base, they're running on all platforms? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I'm not really sure whether that's a single code base or not. When you say single code base, then what you're saying is it's responsive, And then you're also saying that it's probably in React Native Web or something like that, because it will also have to run on apps, or you will be using some Electron 3D happening. But again, like, okay, that could be one thing. I'm not sure whether there are other wallets out there, but is that your core USP?
Yeah, that too. And also, so Flutter is growing a lot popularly, and there is a lot of less ecosystem in the Web3 world for Flutter. This is what I've experienced, like seen. And previously, I'm also working with Celo to build a Dart SDK, like over the past few weeks. So all the blockchains are trying to push hard on Flutter, and I see that Flutter is really easy to build a prototype and MVP, especially in hackathons like these, compared to a native or even React Native for that matter, I believe, because I have tried React Native a bit and I felt Flutter was a bit more easier and intuitive. And apart from that, I think the market for Flutter developers is also growing. So maybe making this would also enable other DApps which are built on Flutter to easily integrate with this wallet without having to deal with a lot of native side, I guess. Because I am a Flutter developer and I know very little native. So I know I would use something like this if it can easily integrate with my DApp.
Can you remind me, and I might not know this, whether you can use Flutter for desktop web stuff?
I'm sorry?
Can you use Flutter for desktop web?
Yeah, it runs in all browsers. Just compiles to JavaScript, so it just essentially runs in a browser.
Got it. Cool. I have some more questions. How do you handle private key security? Mnemonic security.
In the app?
Yes.
Currently, there was a package which just encrypts it in AES, and that's what I'm using. It's just a key value store. So I'm just putting the keys and values in that with the private key, and I'm showing only a few essential details which I need to sign the transaction, like the secret, the address, public key, and the private key. So those three things I'm saving. And then whenever I have to sign the transaction, I'm just getting it from that local store. And then I'm signing the transaction and sending it.
Can that local store be read by anything else than the application?
I don't think so, because that is, I think, the specialty, because there are a lot of other key value stores in Flutter, like you can use just the normal NoSQL database, which stores in the application directory of any phone. And in Android. So I think this not only just stores it in application directory, but also encrypts it with some kind of, I mean, AES is what is the specification, but.
What key is being used for encryption?
For the encryption of the data itself?
Yeah.
That I'm not sure. Like with the library, I think the library itself has
because if the key is inside the code, then that's already like it's vulnerable, right? Because you can always decompile the code and figure out
the key to encrypt the code is not. I mean, it's not within my code base. You're saying the library's code base or something?
Wherever, some code base. Like it should not be in the code base.
Yeah, I think so. Or it might also generate it on the fly whenever like the app runs.
That doesn't work because the key has to be the same.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't work because the key has to be the same.
No, like the first time the encryption takes place.
Second time when you have to decrypt it, the key has to be the same way.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm saying only the first time. Like once
the... Where does the key go? It has to be stored. Either you are inputting it or it is being stored.
Yeah, I think the library is handling it.
It has to be the former. For it to be secure.
Yeah. I think I'll have to research a bit more, take a look at the package a bit more for that.
Cool. Yep, that's it for the questions.
Okay.
Do any other judges have any questions? I think not. Cool. Thanks a lot for that great presentation, Sameer. We'll see you sometime soon. I'll take you off now. Awesome. I'll just bring our next team on board. And while I do that, I'll introduce them. So basically, this is Team 23, Team Ginger. They've built an augmented prototyping for product development. And the AR experience acts as a workflow from interaction to purchase. Sounds very interesting. I'll just wait for them to explain this to me. Just waiting for them to join. Yeah, here they are. I'll just put them on. Hey, Yash. Hey, Sanyu. How are you?
We are good.
Yeah, amazing. You. Amazing. Folks, just take a quick minute to explain your hack, explain the idea, and then try to jump into the demo as soon as you can. I'll put your shared screen on stage. Yeah. And you can just share your presentation. I'll go off now, but I'll start the timer. Yeah. All the best.
Okay. So our hack is called WebAR, a project that is made to increase the sales in store retailers. These retailers have, during the pandemic, their growth and their economy has a downfall. It was because the online stores were getting more attention and people are buying from there. So we need a change in this campaign. We need a rise so they can buzz around their brands. They can have some marketing process where users can engage. So we come up with augmented reality. So to explain augmented reality and its workflow without further ado, I will start with the demonstration. So here you can see the user is just opening a QR code scanner link, such a link that will open such QR codes to our website. It will redirect him to our Project Heroku app, which is made on WebAR, so he can enter this AR world. Here he will be able to not only view these 3D models that I'm going to show you, but he can also interact with them. He can scale them, he can rotate. So let's jump in and see. And these type of markers can be inside these AR shops, like the shop that will be ARified, coining this term. The malls will be getting ARified due to this. So as you can see, he can scale it, he can rotate it. There's a fully interactable 6 degree of freedom support, and they are instant surface placement just as the mark gets detected. The marker can be just their logo, just as this one is for having a FIFA logo, and it loaded up the FIFA football. And this one has the Reebok sneakers. And see how attractive they are. They can not only engage the users, they can make it compelling to them. And this code is not just an aesthetic piece of code. We have a usability to it. If you can see, just as the markers and the models are changing, there is a button down below which allows them to buy it. So let me just show you the animation because that was the coolest part. So one can use these buttons have a one-tap payment solution. Now, what is a one-tap payment solution? Usually, the person has to buy, and then he has to fill a lot of details and everything. Then finally, he gets it. But no, we are planning on its accessibility. We are going to increase the accessibility, and the AR is going to guide the whole workflow from the engagement to this such a beautiful AR experience to the one-tap payment solution. Now let's see what happens if the user, like if I try to buy one of them as I tried. So I'm going to buy this football as in the demo I showed. So I click on this purchase football. So let's see where it redirects to. It redirects to a very basic page where we don't have to fill a lot of details, like I fill my name, mail, and these things are just required. So the retailer will get a mail that this person has like paid for this so that he can get out of the shop. And he has that, he can show a proof for him. And it redirects to the Paytm API, Paytm payment API. This API will allow him to use any UPI IDs and pay. You can see a black screen because this is a kind of encryption that these payment apps have. So you don't see like what is happening behind the passwords. So yeah, here the payment is done. And we had to build this on the Node.js backend. So all of this works. So here comes the usability. It is not just an aesthetic piece of code. It also carries workflow, and it can drive the merchants to have such AR shops in their stores. So So, huh. So to make the crisp and clear features, we talked about the instant market detection, the full integrity of the GLTF model, the one-tap payment solution, and cashless transaction everyone prefers these days. And the best thing about it, the guidance of the whole workflow from ad purchase, which is guided with the help of AR.js. Now coming to our text.js to have this load up with the camera as the background feed. We had this case to have such components and have such models load up in the skybox. So we use AR.js API to make the, instead of a skybox, we replace it with camera as our background. And AFM extras is for the animations like that you saw in the projector, it was animated. So there is an animation component. The gesture.js allows us to rotate and scale it, just as you saw. The payment, the Paytm payment API that allows it to be a usable code and gives it some usefulness, just not as an aesthetic piece of code. And Node.js for the backend, and we deployed it on Heroku. So you can see and test the website and how it goes, and you can see it. So for wrapping up, I would just say that we plan to make a solution where users don't have to like search for a lot of models. There should not be a catalog. This is not an online site. We want the users to engage and have such AR experiences, find it compelling for them to buy. And it is also at the click of a button, that one tap payment solution guided the whole workflow with a clever UX with the help of AR.js. So the user will definitely end up purchasing most likely one or two or maybe even more of these products. So thank you.
Hey Yash, thanks for the presentation. Can you also show a demo of the project?
We tried to screen share, but we need the I showed you the YouTube video, but for that we need screen share feature on this restream, and the phone wasn't allowing it to me, and there was some problem and issues in it. So we end up with
restream only allows sharing screen with the laptop.
Yeah. So we needed these AR supported phones like one could carry. We don't want them to have these laptops and put them in a weird position to scan these models.
You can change your setting to show your get your video feed, your camera, and then show like put your phone against the camera and show it like.
Yeah, just put the camera in front of the key, like phone in front of the camera and show on the phone.
Oh, sorry.
If I want to show it, I have to first scan these marker images now. So like, it will be a like, the angles won't do it.
Oh. Can you not take the markers like?
If I can try doing one thing, I can like share screen again, and I will put my laptop in a weird position, and I will try that it loads up for you.
Sure.
So let me just see if you can do it. It
allows. Dude, you can also use something like screen copy, no? SCRCPY, which basically copies your phone content on your laptop, and then you can screen share your laptop. It will be very easy. It's a one-line command, like it's just like screen sharing your phone to your laptop, and then laptop you can screen share on the stream. That can also work out.
Yeah, I understood what you said. Like I have to like download these BMGs and then.
There's a very small SCRCPY.
In the real time.
But yeah, I guess it will take some time to set it up if you don't have like ADB etc. installed. I don't know.
I mean, for now, you don't need to. You just need to scan the code, right? After scanning the code, when the AR model is displayed in the phone, you can just turn the phone to the camera and show us how it is looking in the real device.
Okay, sure. So I think you can see my video right now. I should stop screen sharing. So let's see if it will do from here. So if you can see my phone, I'm just, I'm just opening a QR code scanner, like any website would do it. I hope the camera angles are easy to like make it visible. Yeah. So I think, this will do. So on the very left of the screen, you can see the QR code. I'm going there and I'm going to scan it. Let me show you what happened. It opened the WebAR project that I have made. So it says something like, if the camera angle will allow me, and I think I should, yeah. It says something like, expect the Unreal, enter the AR world. And let's see if I can show the marker detection and if it will allow me to like show you these models loaded up. So I will just continue with it. I don't know if you can see it, but like if I were to take a screenshot of it, it would look like this. I don't think it is like showing up the way it should look like. I think you can see it. I don't know.
Yeah, we can.
Is it visible?
We can figure out what's going on.
So what it is doing is, just as the marker, it finds it. So the AR model gets loaded up, and it has some preset animations. Like if I could like show you from if it recently would allow me to directly show it, that would be way too easier. So basically, I have this like kind of setup I made in my own house, and I've made like this can be a mall kind of setup. The mall can showcase 2-3 or maybe as many number of products as they want, and one can scan the QR code, hop into the mall, and they can keep searching for markers, the showcase markers, and they can have such AR experiences. So it will find them compelling. Plus this one tap buying solution that I made. So overall, it is like very clever UX to make these payments happen. So yeah, that was like what I made. That was it.
Cool, awesome. Rajit, I think we were not able to hear you. You were saying something. Yeah.
Oh, am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. I was asking, so how do the shop owners create these augmentations, create these models? Will the same app work for them?
The same app can work for them, and they can have these builds, they can have the models from the side, but if the company it. Like in 2018, Adidas made a like a showcase view the future, and it made such models loaded up at the scan of image target. At that time, is they were just to show how, but didn't have the workflow from the advertising to the purchasing. So we are doing something on the next level. If it can bring profit to the retailers also, and they can buy it, so the companies can also establish such AR and such market. Or it can come to those retailers from there, or the retailers have it set up on their own.
Got it. Thanks. That's all the questions I have.
Cool. Awesome. Any other questions from any other judges? Cool. I guess that's all the questions that we have for your team, Yash. Thank you
so much for having me here.
For sure. We'll catch you later. See you.
Okay, see you. Bye.
Cool. So that was Team Ginger. I'm just getting our next team on stage. Hey there. Hey, Yogesh, how are you, man?
Hey, how are you guys? I'm good.
I'm just waiting for the rest of your teammates to drop in. So folks, these are this is team number 19, team hashtag include, and they are trying to digitalize healthcare. Pretty excited to see what you guys have to offer. If you could just share your screen, I'll put it on stage.
Sure.
Try to devote more time for your demos, yeah?
Sure.
Cool. Your screen is live. I'll drop off now.
Okay. So, hi, everyone. This is Harsh, and Yogesh is in my team. And there's one more guy, Yaksh. He couldn't join due to some emergencies. So, yeah, we make team hash include. So, just to start with, I would like to ask, what's the strongest thing in the world? People say it's diamond, but I believe that it's community. The power of community is something which cannot be broken at any time of point. So what if we combine the power of community and healthcare together? Combining these awesome things that we are targeting upon. A step towards Digital Bharat. So whenever we hear Digital Bharat, the first thing that comes in our mind is cashless transactions, less paperwork, and everything. But in healthcare industry, when we see we have to carry a lot of files or we have to search for old prescriptions and everything whenever we visit a doctor, or the doctor has to maintain some kind of prescriptions or the records of your health so that he can treat you better. So to solve out this problem, we are introducing Physic, which is an online digital platform where doctors can communicate with doctors. It's an online community, I would say, rather, of doctors where the patient can go and find its cure very easily and effectively. So I was just scrolling Wikipedia and I found that these are the countries listed down, as you can see, but India is somewhere countries with free but not universal healthcare. So universal healthcare is something which we want to bring in at India as well and worldwide. So basically what we are trying to build is a community of doctors, an online presence inspired by Stack Overflow. So we hear about developers community, we have about marketing folks communities and everything. We have Discord channels and whatnot. But do you have ever heard like about the doctors of community? No. So we are inspired by Stack Overflow. We are trying to build up a community of doctors where people can learn through experience. So basically, if I want to share my knowledge through others, a doctor wants to share his knowledge through others, he can take up a patient's records and he can share them anonymously on the portal, and the other doctors can like, see, comment, and everything. So basically, we are trying to learn through experience because these are things that are done practically. Help to get help. So this is very simple. You help others to get help. No second opinion. So what generally happens is if I'm having a mild fever or anything, I will tell my father and my father will consult 10 other people and get me a medicine. But we won't directly consult a doctor at, you know, maybe due to the cost of that appointment or anything. So we are trying to eliminate these steps and directly connect with doctor, maybe at a cheaper rate or free of cost. So I'll just bring out a small story before going. So this is Alice, and Alice has, let's say, diabetes. So as I say, like whenever I'm having some fever or anything, like my father will consult 10 more people. So she also got confused by the several variety of folks out there. Like everyone saying, do this, do this, do this. But what she actually had to do. So she was very confused. Everyone, like if I'm at having some health issues, so I will be also definitely panicked. And so we bring Physic where she can come and create a profile directly. She can upload the past medical records if she is having, like maybe some diabetic report or any kind of health or anything that she went in the past. So the online community of doctors, as I mentioned, so they must be discussing something around diabetes or some any kind of disease out there on the platform. So if they wish to make it publicly available to that person, they can do it at a single click and they don't need to waste all their times again and again. So through this platform, Alice found a doctor, maybe Dr. A, whom she consulted and she got the better cure. All this was very virtual and online. So if she needed an offline consultation, she can directly contact him or her and go to their clinic and everything. So this is a sneak peek into our UI. So this is the digital identity that I was talking about. Basically, we are carrying a credit card always. So why not a health card? Just like an Aadhaar card maybe. Just swipe it or just scan it and you get all the information. The doctor gets all the information upon the approval of the patient. So basically, if I'm visiting any clinic, I don't need to carry all those heavy loads of files, just like my school bag. I just need to carry this slim, trim, and good-looking card.
one last thing. We see a future. Like, this is not just the end, but we are planning to make an open source community where people can, you know, like the crowd-based statistics and libraries for various diseases. Like, you just don't need to, like, whenever I'm having fever, if I do a Google search, it will show that I am going to die in 2 days. So, yeah, that shouldn't happen. And appropriate news should be given to him. So, yeah. And upon the future, like, we can have a chat between the patient doctors and doctor to doctors on this platform even. And for this, talking about the technologies and a demo. So we have built this on the robust technologies, the latest technologies like React, TypeScript, Node.js, Express, and MongoDB. Yogesh will give the demo now, I guess. Yogesh, I guess you can show.
Yeah. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, just a second, I'll put it on. Yeah, it's live now.
So basically, this is the login page, and this is the registration page. So whenever a doctor registers, they have to provide all the info and their license ID, which will be then verified on the admin side. And once that doctor is verified, they'll be able to make contributions to the community. So I'll log in real quick. So this is the doctor's dashboard. Up in here, as you can see right off the bat, we have a section for emergencies. Whenever a doctor creates a post, they have an option to mark it as an emergency, so that that can be showcased to the community as soon as possible. So this is how a post would look like. And other doctors will be able to put their opinions on it, and the people from the community, which will be doctors, will be able to upload it. Verified doctors can give these opinions, not the users. So that is that. We have another section for trending posts up in here. There is another example of a post. And on the dashboard, we have another section that is called profile, and it showcases all the info of the doctor, their recent posts and reports. So the doctor can also have all the info about their patient in the same application. So whenever they are making a post, they can reference it anonymously. So they can have a whole patient history with their prescriptions and if there are any kind of medical history that the patient has. And they can explore through all the posts on the platform. So, yeah. That is basically what we were able to do so far.
We have a few more screens which we designed, but we were not able to implement all those because of the time stream. So we have shared the Figma link with the judges, I guess. So you can definitely have a look over there. Like, we have made the patient site as well, but we were not able to implement it on the code basis. And I guess. I guess we are open to questions. So,
yeah.
Judges, do we have any questions for team hashtag include? That was some crazy good design, by the way, folks. Really loved them.
Thank you so much. Glad that you like it.
Don't really have any questions, but yeah, I want to just echo the same sentiment that pretty good design.
I just missed the tech stack piece. So what have you used on the technical side?
Yep, sure. For the backend, we have used Node.js and TypeScript. Like, everything is on TypeScript for us. So on the backend, it's Node.js. And for the database, we are using MongoDB. And for the front end, we are using React. And for the hosting, we plan to do on AWS. But since we showed it on a live demo, we didn't plan to host it.
And this was the first time of me using TypeScript. So it got a bit more adventurous. I had to learn it and implement, like contribute from my side as well.
By the way, me and Yogesh met for the first time over this hack. So it was really amazing.
Yeah, it was.
And I share the same sentiment. The design is really amazing. And the fact that you have been able to implement these many screens in almost the same design is pretty good. Congrats for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, I don't have any other questions.
Cool, cool. In that case, we'll move on to the next team. Thanks a lot, Yogesh and Harsh. That was some presentation.
Really, thank you so much. It was a pleasure presenting to you.
Okay, amazing, amazing. Cool. We'll catch you guys later. If you could just click the leave button on the top right. Yeah. Thanks a lot. Cool. We'll just quickly bring our next team on stage. And while we do that, I'll introduce them. So the next team is team number 25, Team Tech Phantoms. And they've built an app called College Mate, and it aims to make college life easier for students. They've actually given a pretty descriptive. Yeah, hey there. Hey Prakar, how are you?
Hello, sir. Sir, I'm good. How are you?
Hey, don't call us sir. We're roughly your age. Anyway, we're good. We're good. Where are your teammates? Where are your teammates? Just waiting for them.
So they're just joining in, I guess.
Yeah, they're here. Cool. Awesome. Folks, if you could just share your screen and get underway, I'll just put your screen on stage. And yeah, leave you to it.
Sir, two more of our teammates are just joining in, I guess.
Yeah, not a problem. I'll just put them on as they come in. Okay, yeah, you can start in the meanwhile. Okay.
So you can start, right?
Yeah, you can start now.
Okay. So basically what we have built is a website known as College Mate. Basically, we are sophomores from IIIT Allahabad. And one problem that we faced in college was like, we don't have something to manage our expenses, like what we have to do next. Like there's nothing, like obviously there are many apps around wherein you can track expenses and there's a to-do list app also, but there's not a single place wherein you can track all these together. So what we made is we made a website wherein you can log in and you can track your expenses. You can store your data. One more, store your to-dos, like the things you have to do. And one more thing we faced is like, we all are into competitive coding. So we give contests. So we tend to miss a lot of contests. So we created a contest tracker that uses an external API to fetch the upcoming contest and the current ongoing contest and display it on the screen. If I could just give you a little demo of it. This is a login page. So we implemented the login using Firebase. We basically all the authorization work is done using Firebase. So this is the login page. It will get redirected to his profile page. Then we have three components. The first one is contest. This data is being fetched from an external API. So these are the ongoing contests that are currently going on HackerEarth and various other coding platforms. So you can slide into upcoming contests as well. So clicking there is slide. Huh. So these are the upcoming contests. You can click on compete, obviously, to like go there and register yourself. So our second component is an expense tracker that we have built. In this, sir, we have tried to implement a very cool feature. Like we have used an external API, speech API. So like you can talk and like add your expense. If Pooja could show a demo for the same.
Add income for category, 1 second. Add income for 100 in category gifts for Tuesday.
So the expense gets added and the charts are re-rendered again on fly. So this is our expense tracker page, and the third page we have and the second page we have is an activity log, basically a to-do list type. But in this, like an additional feature that we have created is, like, suppose if I'm working on two projects simultaneously, one is College Meet and one is XYZ, I have to add a file in College Meet. So I can create a new project, namely College Meet, and in that I can add a given tool. So that's a little of like a little unique feature that I thought of adding. This is the to-do list, basically the expense tracker thing. How you can add in, these transitions we gave using React Spring. So, this is it. Hello?
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are you folks done? Prakhar, Pooja, Pranav, can you post me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Is everything done from your end?
Yes, sir.
Cool. Judges, any questions for Team Tech Phantoms?
Remind me, you showed two different applications, right?
Sir, yeah, but basically, those are three components which we have rendered it into a single project. One is expense tracker, one is activity log, and one is the contest. These are three components which is.
Why tackle three different types of problems and
because these problems are individually tackled in many places. Like, obviously you can show the to-dos on Google Sheets. This all works fine. But what we did is, like, you can log in and see all of these together. Like, you can at a single place, you can see your expenses, you can see your to-dos, you can see the upcoming contest. So it basically gives a user satisfaction kind of thing. Like, it gives user a better experience, I guess.
Okay. I mean, you have to anyways shift to different screens, right? You have to shift to the different screens. You could very well have three different tabs open on your browser and do the same thing. So I don't really see how it solves a problem. That was one. And like any counters on that?
Sir, I mean that's a thing. I completely agree to it. But we thought this would be a really cool startup project for us to, like, step into the world of tech.
Oh, so you haven't really developed many things before this?
No, sir. This was our first hackathon and our first development.
Good. I like the fact that at least, like, you were able to start off things like this. Why use voice recognition on the expense strategy?
Sir, that was, I guess, it's a very cool feature, and the Speechly API, sir, we heard about it in open code. One guy told us about it. So, like, he read the documentation and he tried implementing it, and it was working perfectly fine. And it's really very easy to train it. So we thought.
So basically, again, you wanted to try it out, so you basically try it out. Right?
Yes, sir.
All right, that's it for the question for now.
Any other questions from any of our judges? I guess not. In which case, thanks a lot for presenting Team Tech Phantoms. Hope you guys had a great time, had a great first hackathon experience here. Yeah?
Yes, sir, definitely.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Looking forward to it very much.
For sure. We'll catch you later. Yes. If you could just click the leave button on the top right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Cool. I'll just quickly bring our next team on stage. But before I do that, I just want to... I'm feeling good about the fact that Hackout is actually the first experience for some teams. And some teams are actually getting formed due to Hackout. So the previous team, the team members had met in Hackout's Discord itself. So yeah, I guess we are doing something right. Sounds great. Anyway, I'll just quickly introduce the next team. It's called Team Abraka Data, and it's team number 30. Just waiting for their members to join. Yeah, here they are. I can see Varang. How are you, Varang? I hope I'm pronouncing the name correct. You're on mute, buddy. Saurav is here as well.
I'm audible, right?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, that's great. Cool.
Cool.
Am I audible?
Yeah, yes. All right. Samarth, if you could just turn your camera on.
Yeah, actually, he's going to show our demo. So our demo is going to use camera, so he won't be able to turn it on for a while.
Yeah. Cool. Not a problem. No. Super excited to see what you folks are going to present. Yeah.
Samarth, just present your screen and then you can start the time.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is now.
Yeah, it's visible. Great. So let's make it full screen. Yeah. So can we start now?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah. So good evening, respected judges. I'm Varang Rai. And my team members are Samarth Singhal. He's going to show the demo here. Saurabh Pal and Pranav Goyal. So we are Delhi Technological University undergrad students, third year students trying to make something innovative. So our team name is Abraka Data. So we'll just straight and jump to the problem statement first. So the next slide, Samarth. The project's name is the project's name is going to be DeepRocketer. So the idea behind our project is that we are going to address a very, very important problem that we as students have been facing over the past 1 year. And not only students, but I think people all across the industry, software industry, students, schools, students, everybody is facing. That is exam proctoring. So about 1 year back, there was this trend of about before 1 year. So there was official offline invigilation. So there was a teacher who could actually watch you. And in case you're doing any malpractice, the teacher would automatically identify that this guy, he's cheating. Please remove him from the exam. But what about online exams? There are so many challenges there. People are simply conducting an exam on a Google form. And that's all. So we have done literature review in this field, what existing methods are there. And we have analyzed them and have tried to improve upon them. So two things. First is the manual proctoring part. That is when there is an invigilator who is going to manually watch your video. So there are various third-party companies, people who actually offer this service. And the second part is going to automate this whole process of AI proctored invigilation. So over to the next slide, Samarth. Yeah. So first thing here are the problem is actually there. People are cheating in online exams, online software industry exams. Like we were appearing for internships and our friends across colleges. So there were so many malpractice happening. People, there were answers floating around in Telegram groups. And so many things. So it's a pretty hot topic and it needs to be addressed as soon as possible. So here are a couple of newspaper headlines that we found online. So the problem is there. Now we are going to address the solution. Next slide, Samarth. So here's a tech stack, TensorFlow, Python, Colab, OpenCV, standard deep learning frameworks. So deep learning is the main tech stack we are going to use. That is to analyze the webcam images of the camera. Next slide, Samarth. Yeah, so the first part is the manual proctoring part. So currently we have the system in place. There are people who offer the service. They can watch your video stream. But how about, are we really comfortable in sharing a video stream with the third person? Isn't there a privacy concern? So over to Samarth, he'll now show you the demo for this part. So Samarth, can you just start the demo?
Yeah.
So the thing is that we are not even comfortable in sharing our profile picture with somebody we don't even know. We often lock our Facebook profile pictures. So how are we comfortable in sharing a 3-hour video stream while taking an online test with someone we don't even know? And we are living in an era. It's mind you, we are living in an era of deep fakes. In fact, if we have time in the end, I'll present a former US President Barack Obama's photo video in which he's actually saying something that he's not supposed to say. And in the end, we realize it's a deep fake. So the first part is the crypto AI part. So Samarth, can you just...
Loading. Just a second.
Sure, anytime. Yeah. So show the demo part one. So what our solution to this is when the invigilator is seeing, so this is Samarth's side, he's taking the exam. Yeah, it's just loading. So he's taking the exam, he has this exam in place. Yeah, so we'll just refresh it. Your video stream is in there. It's loading, I guess.
Is it loaded?
Just a second.
Can you see the stream?
No, we can't see.
Wait, let me then.
Figuring. So the main idea behind it is going to be that when we are transferring the video to the invigilator site, why don't we simply blur out the non-essential parts of the face that are not relevant for the student, for the invigilator. So
is my camera on in the stream?
Yeah, I think it's because of so you should disconnect this part.
Mm-hmm. So okay.
Yeah, maybe because of that.
Yeah. So it's okay. We can move on to the
Yeah. So we'll just show you in the end. Like, I think it's because of his camera is on. So here is the first crypto AI part. The second part of our program, it's going to be about YOLO part. So Samarth, will you show the crypto AI or should you proceed with the YOLO part?
I will show you the YOLO first.
Okay. So we'll show you the YOLO part. So this is the second part. It's going to be the AI part of our project. So in this case, what we are going to do, we are going to use the webcam stream of the candidate, and we are going to detect mainly three things. First, is there another person present in the room? Second, is the person using a phone? And third, is the person distracted? Is he looking left or is he looking right? For these three things, we are going to utilize three main frameworks. One is a YOLO framework. It's a very, very highly sophisticated algorithm and model available that has been trained for numerous days on various images. So that's going to detect if there is a person present in the room or a phone. Second part is going to be the mouth detection part. If somebody is talking, it will automatically flag that the person is talking, and he may be talking to someone who is not visible in the camera frame. Mm-hmm. And the third part is going to be the head pose estimation part. So in case the candidate is looking left or right, it will automatically flag the candidate. So
I think there is an issue because of the thing.
I think
not letting me do it.
You should close this tab, run that, and maybe like block the camera permissions over here.
Yeah.
I'll take your time. Just block the camera permissions and refresh this page.
Mm.
Yeah.
Can you hear? I think you cannot hear me now, right?
Yeah, we can hear you. I think you'll have to refresh the page. Yeah, so just give us a few seconds.
What's an online hackathon without glitches?
Like, it's mainly that the web browser is trying to use the camera as well as the application.
If you shut down just the, like, I didn't really notice it, but like if you just turned off the camera, it wasn't allowing, right?
Maybe. So we'll move on to the theory part. I'll just explain our motivation behind this. So first thing, the privacy part is something that hasn't been addressed before, and this is something novel we are doing. Second part is the AI detection part. In that thing, we have used deep learning frameworks. Yeah, that's awesome, Samarth. Wow, that's great. So this is the crypto AI part we were talking about. So candidate is taking the exam. He can see his video stream. That's all right. He has few instructions. He has the test paper. That's well and good. But do we want the invigilator to also have all this information? I can take his face, deepfake it in, for some nefarious purposes. So let's move on to the invigilator side. So this is how the invigilator should see. Yeah, so this is the invigilator site. He has opened. I want to see Samarth taking an exam. So, wow, voila, that's great. So here is Samarth. So why, Samarth, that's great. So we only need his eyes part in case he's looking left or right, and his mouth part is if he's talking or not. So that's great. Now I cannot decipher who this person is. We cannot use it for some other purpose. We can maybe blur it more. We can maybe put a mask on it. So this is amazing. A very intuitive approach, yet we think it's going to be very effective. So this is the first part. Now you can move on to the automated YOLO part, Samarth. Yeah, so essentially this thing is going to use Samarth's camera. We have provided a source of zero. That's to use the first source that's available in the webcam. So it's going to run TensorFlow. That's the deep learning library. So deep learning, essentially it works very well with images. As soon as we want to classify something in images are very complex data. So deep learning is a very mathematical computer science intersection field, and it's able to analyze those cameras just a few more seconds. Still no error, so it's actually running, I guess. Yeah, great. Yeah, awesome, Samarth. That's great. So as you can see, this is Samarth's site. So essentially, all these things won't be happening on the local computer. So this is Samarth being detected. So this is percent. So it's we can see in the CMD also that it's showing 1% is there. So as soon as Samarth brings a cell phone in frame, yeah, so it's detecting a cell phone. So a cell phone is detected and it's noted down. One cell phone was detected. If he looks left or right, yeah. So if he looks left or right, so this is also detected. Yeah, so we can see in the top left, and it's also being shown in the CMD that he's looking left or right. So this is what, if you can open your mouth, Samarth, it will show that he's not talking, mouth open. So it's, we can see in the CMD also that it's showing that mouth is open. So this is just a demonstration how all these things are going to happen in the backend. So this concludes the second part, and it's going to be feature rich. Right now we have three features. I have the fourth feature. That is, what if the person is smart enough and he's not tilting his head, but only moving his eyeballs? Like if you can see me right now. So that's the third thing, fourth thing we have worked upon. If you have time, I'll just present that too. But that's the fourth thing we have worked upon. But the last portion is the taskman portion we'd like to address. So what we thought was, people are definitely monitoring us through the camera. There is one person, I'm taking the exam, I'm being monitored. But what about my computer? I mean, we are living in an era where softwares like TeamViewers exist. They can take control of your computer. You can stay in front of your in front of the webcam, and it will seem that I am taking the exam. But what if there's somebody else? What if there's some background process open? So we thought, why not create a very simple Python script? Yet we estimate that it's going to be very effective. That will run in background. It will scan if some specific set of applications are open. Let's say TeamViewer, any other tab, or Zoom. If it is open, then it sends a red flag. Yes, these programs are open. And the red flag is sent. So Samarth has actually opened, had already opened it. So it's checking for every 5 seconds that if this program is open or not. So yeah, so this is the log part. We just open it to Notepad. So it can be seen that these programs are open along with the timestamp. So this is something that is very simple, but very effective. And so this concludes the final part, the Taskman part of a project. So these were the three main aspects we have worked upon. This adds an extra dimension to the proctoring. Now the end part was we were just thinking, like, why don't we deploy it? First thing, we didn't actually have a deployment guy in our team. But apart from that, the vision we have for this product, I think it's a very, very, very useful product. The number of people who can actually benefit from this product is not in lakhs, but in millions. We have it's not only for online exams, but it can be extended to, let's say, JEE mains. JEE mains, 15 lakh people are taking this exam in online offline blend mode. And there are around, I took JEE mains around 3 years back. There were 3 invigilators in the room. And how can they see so many people in this room at the same time? So why not, whatever existing software we researched a bit, TCS has employed a software over there just for taking the exam. So why don't we integrate this part? We have the open source part with that specific TCS software. These two in blend, voila, we have another AI system in an offline manner. Maybe in future, we can also remove invigilators from there. So it can be deployed under various scenarios. So making it just web browser to web browser, we can like deploy it on cloud or something like that. So we are not limiting ourselves through that, but open to whatever field we want to extend it to. So the second part is that the final part, concluding part, is that we want to extend this, extend the members of our team to more people, have a cloud architect who can do that. Employ it for, let's say, a Google form. Somebody's taking an exam on a Google form. Employ it in that kind of scenario and various. So I think that concludes our part. So thank you for...
Amazing, amazing. Varang, Saurav, Samar, that was a really smart presentation. I'll just open the floor for questions from our judges now.
Hey, Varang, Saurav. Thank you for the presentation. I had a question about the actual deployment. So all the image detection that you have done using cameras, that can be done in just the browser, right? Like whichever application you use to take the test, that same application can support taking the camera feed and doing all these measures. How will the Taskman be actually deployed?
Yeah, precisely. So we actually tried a lot. Web browsers, Chrome, they do not allow you to at all look beyond the browsers. There is no possible way for that. You have to enter OS level and it gets complicated. So one thing, the user, if he's taking an exam for a software industry job, he's getting some salary. I think he should have some seriousness to install one software. So perhaps we are entering a new era of online exams. He will get a guidelines, install one software, Taskman, integrated, log in it, some sort of authorization. So that will be connected to the server side. So that one thing will be running in the person's computer, and it's not going to exhaust any resources. It's a very lightweight application. Apart from that, everything can happen in the browser or on the cloud. So this is one thing, but I think it's completely feasible.
So how do you ensure that the Taskman is running on the same computer? That could be running on a different computer, right? So you tell the candidate and they ran the Taskman on a different computer and given the Taskman a separate one.
Yeah, I think we can, there are ways we can actually make that. So like we haven't explored the networking, the computer networking part of it, but we can ensure that the browser and the same. So I think those are more about the implementation part. So I think there are ways we can ensure that part too.
All right, but you'll also check if the project is running. If the Taskman is, for example, stopped, then that will also flag an alert. Like if somebody stops the script, that will also flag.
Taskman is stopped. Absolutely.
Also, like you asked about the how can you check? There is, I think, I'm not sure about it, but like there is this game I play, like it's called Valorant. So they provide anti-cheats. So for
they work on the OS level. In this case, your one software is running on the OS level, another is running in the browser. There's no correlation. That's so, the concept. So the browser will have its own sandbox. So cool. That's all. There is one question in the comments. Should I just read it out? The question is, wouldn't it be too stressful for the exam without moving the eye at all? In 3 hours, for example, without even moving the eye at all?
First thing, you can look around the screen. It's not that you have to stare exactly at the center of the screen. There are thresholds. So in any case, such as where you're getting in data, statistical methods come into play. So we are exploring the maths, statistical methods. When you get that data, actually, we can even log file. We have a specific log how many times.
I think Varang's voice is a little bit. But his point is being, we have the log files of everything that is being happening. So we have all that recorded. And according to the strictness of the invigilation and how the company wants us to invigilate, we can manage accordingly how strict or like how many alerts will it take for our proctor to maybe consider this as a cheating or not. So, yeah.
Right. So I just want to know, like, the blurring part that you have, does that work when your face shifts left and shifts right?
Yeah, to some extent it does work. So it does work. So right now we have, there is 68 facial key points. The blurring part, I'll just tell you the maths behind it. So what it's essentially doing is using 68 facial key points around the face, and it detects eyes and the mouth, and it leaves the other options out. So this 68 facial key points currently, they are on 2D plane, but we have actually the papers with us right now. There are more facial key points which can actually plot in 3D. So not 68, but 128, which will also cover the other parts of our face. So right now, I think if we look extremely left out of the frame, it may not do so. But so just changing that data set from 68 facial key points to 128, it can be extended to left or right also.
Can you show me in your demo till what level it is blurred?
Yeah, we can show that, Samarth.
Yep, let me just...
By the time you sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Okay, by the time you are setting it up, let me ask something else. What is the crypto part in this?
No, crypto is just a name we came up with. Nothing related to cryptocurrency.
Yeah, you're just doing marketing.
Yeah. Probably a fancy, a very fancy name going around. People are just crazy behind this. No, why not include it? So just a name.
Not the right way.
Oh yeah, but yeah, it's nothing crypto about it. But
okay. I had another question, but I think let me
see. Like crypto is, it's not cryptocurrency. Crypto is an, it means secret. So that's where we were going in. Secret.
I thought there'll be something related to cryptography in this.
No.
That's where crypto comes from, but yeah.
No, it's just a name. I think like if I was to highlight the project, so I would highlight it less, the technical aspects, deep learning, very popular. So yeah, it's actually
go to the farthest left that you can go, and let me see left or right, whatever direction. Let me see till at what point it breaks. You can turn your body also if you want. Okay, so this, it broke almost at 80 degrees.
Yeah. So perhaps like when the candidate is taking exam, he is actually told not to look left or right, the distraction detector. So. Right. But again, this is, I just told you, we have actually explored. These points are being plotted on 2D. There are very similar ways, 68 points extended to 128 plot on 3D. So just under the implementation parts, we have explored that part too. So, but again, what I wanted to highlight about what we have done, why this problem statement, because we think the number of people who are going to benefit from this currently and who are going to be directly impacted around us are huge, 15 lakh millions to estimate. And it's something that needs to be addressed ASAP. Due to pandemic, there are problems posed to all sectors, and ultimately whoever is going to graduate from this semester is going to affect the future life. So I think future of country, future GDP of country, if I'll go to that extent also, it's at stake. So extend this. This is the implementation part. I'll just conclude with that.
Cool, got it. For the last program that you were showing, which was giving checking every few seconds and seeing if there is some other program running or not.
Yeah.
Is it just checking from a list of programs that are running, or is it checking for programs that are actually looking into your camera and taking a feed from it?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you properly.
The program, the daemon that was running. It was checking for some programs, like you said, whether Zoom is running or something else is running.
Right? Yeah.
Now, is it checking for a list of programs, from a list of programs, whether they are running or not? Or is it just checking, or is it checking for programs which are taking in your camera feed?
Yeah. So, not camera. I'm not entirely sure. It's like essentially task manager is there. Task manager has certain programs. It's scanning that. It's nothing related to camera.
So you have a list of programs.
Yeah, that's running from CMD.
It's running from that list of programs. It's gonna.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was the use case of this?
Use case of this, I'll just reiterate. So what our use case is, we have task manager. It has various programs running. So we'll get a list of all these programs that are running, and in case it matches one of our target programs,
what is the use case?
Use cases, I'm in front of you, I'm taking an exam. So face verification is done. Very good. There is only one person. I'm not going to bring a camera, but I'm not taking the exam. There is TeamViewer running in the background. TeamViewer is taking the exam. Somebody who's very good at whatever test I'm taking. So shouldn't that TeamViewer be detected? That's something very, I mean, that's something that should be addressed. A very simple program, it's able to detect that. So there are various screen sharing software that can most of the web browsers cannot detect, such as Discord. Or we were just having a meet in that. So it can detect Discord as a application running in background. So that's the use case. So maybe I can screen share my entire screen, share my questions with somebody, and he can send the solutions to me. So that's another thing. So
yeah, so my problem with this thing is that you're not detecting whether screen share is happening or someone is doing some tunneling thing. You're just searching for specific programs. Someone could write a custom program to do those things. So that is what my problem is with that.
So I'll just counter that with something I've experienced. So it was in 12 boards. There was a person who was caught with a chit of paper. He claimed that I just had that chit of paper. I wasn't using it for screen sharing in that case for writing the answers. But the fact that he had a chit of paper is wrong. It's like we are dealing not on a trust basis, but on a very factual basis. If he has a program open, whether it's screen sharing or not, that's wrong. So I think you are going in that direction.
Not exactly. Didn't really compromise my point, but we can take this afterwards. We're running out of time.
Sure, sure.
Okay. All right.
So we have actually done case study, so we have answers in case there are any more questions.
I think we're out of time.
Yeah. We'll continue the discussion later on. But it was a great discussion nonetheless. Cool. Thank you, team Abracadabra. That was a great presentation. We'll see you folks later. Yeah. Cool. I'll just bring my next team on board. Before I do that, team Abracadabra actually reminded me of my college hackathon team's name, which was Avada Kedavra, which is somewhat based on the similar themes. Anyway, just something that came to mind. I'll quickly bring the next team on board. But before I do that, I'll introduce them. So the next team, which is also the second last team, is team number 39. Their name is Hack Elite. And they've built a tool which allows you to upload handwritten code and compile it, which sounds really exciting. Here they are. Hey, Amok, how are you?
Yeah, fine.
Cool. Just waiting for your teammates to join in.
Yeah, they are joining in.
Yeah. There's Herschel. Cool. Folks, you can start sharing your screen.
I think.
Try to spend more time on your demo. Yeah. Cool. We can see your screen. I'll drop off now. All the best.
Yeah. Thank you. Hey everyone. We are Team Hack Elite, and our team consists of Amog Nagar, Gaurav Sinha, and Harshal Raikwa, and myself. And our project name is Code Mirror. Play around with the code while we make sure you aren't lost. Next slide, please. Yeah. So the problem it solves. Around 24 million students don't have proper access to computer. Due to this, students are compelled to write their code on the pen, with the help of pen and paper, and they can have a huge mistake and they cannot recognize it. Most of the students learn programming with the help of pen and paper. This becomes very difficult as it is nearly impossible to check the handwritten code whether it is syntactically correct or wrong. So we created an application called Code Mirror. So it simply allows you to take a picture or upload your handwritten code, and we will extract the code and it will run on your browser. It will facilitate students with the limited or no access to computer. It supports various programming languages such as C, C++, Python, and JavaScript. You can also view your previously scanned QR codes. Next slide. So how we built it. So the site is built using Node.js Express for the backend. We are using React.js for the frontend. We are using Google Cloud Vision API for extracting the Firebase for as a database, and for styling we are using Tailwind CSS and JDoodle API for creating the compiler.
Sorry to interrupt, but there's a lot of static noise coming in from someone's mic. So if you could just mute yourself, if you're not speaking.
Wait, sorry.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. Sorry. So the applications are, you just need to upload the handwritten image of your code, and we will extract the code out of them. And it is easy to use, as you just need to upload an image, and you can also check your history of the code that you have updated. So the challenges we ran into, as the most of the teammates in our team was attending the hackathon for the first time, so it was really new for them to learn skills such as collaboration. But we did, but we all did a really great job. We collaborated together and tackle various problems. And another challenge was to implementing the code extraction from the image that is uploaded by the user. For that, we are using Google Cloud Vision API. Next slide. Sorry. So what we are planning next for the code mirror? So we will add more languages such as JavaScript and other Rust and Ruby. You can also share your code with other students, and we are and we will try to create our own OCR model for the text extraction. Thank you. Hope you had loads of fun today. Now let's head over to the lab demo. Over to you, Amok.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, so this is the live demo of our website, of our web app. So first of all, the user has to land on this page where the user has to upload the picture of the handwritten code. So let me upload it. The image that I will upload is this code. It is written on Python. So let me upload it. Yeah. So the Google Cloud Vision API extracted all those code from the image and just put it here. And here I have to select the language of the code that I have wrote, that I have uploaded. And it is the Google Cloud Vision API just extracted the code, and let me correct it. Yeah. So if I hit on convert, Yeah. Now, if I hit on convert, yeah, so it will give me error because in the line two, there is no indentation because Python follows indentation. Yeah.
You forgot to change the language.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so here is the output of the code, and we can also download this code output as a file, and also copy this code. And not only this, we can also view the history of the code snippets that I have uploaded, like this. These are all the code snippets that I have uploaded, and we can also view this, and we can also view the profile of me, of the user. Like in the profile page, we can also view the number of files that I have uploaded. And in the future scope, we are also thinking to implement a visualizer of the code, which just visualizes our code into flowcharts, so that the newbies, like the newcomers, can easily understand the code, what that code is doing. And we are also thinking to implement a progressive web app of this website. And And we are also thinking to implement a code sharing functionality, where the user just have to like in case of WhatsApp, now we can share the text, we can share the chats of that WhatsApp between different social media apps. So we are also trying to implement this feature in our web app, where the user just can share this output of the code between various social media apps. So And we are also trying to implement a take photo image where the user can click the image, click the photo of that code using camera. So this is our take photo image. Here the camera will come. Yeah. So this is our project. Hello.
Yeah, great presentation, folks. I'll just open the floor for questions from our judges.
Cool. So you had that OCR problem in between, right? Where you had to adjust the code. How do you solve that?
We are actually planning to create our own OCR model, and we will train it so that it will give us
the Google OCR model. Will you be able to beat it?
Sorry?
You are using Google's OCR model.
Yes.
Will you be able to beat it?
But like, we cannot actually beat that, but we will try our best to create a model which will give us the maximum accuracy.
But this is my question, right? Like, you are saying you are going to basically create something better than what Google has done.
Actually, it is like, no, it won't be that really, because Google has a lot of data set with it, and that amount of data set is not easy to collect by us. But we will actually try our best to, our model cannot actually beat the Google Cloud model for sure. But we will try our best to make it yes. as accurate as we can.
If you're saying it can't beat it, then might as well just use Google's OCR. Why even work for building
your... The problem with Google OCR is, like, as we are using Google Cloud, and it is not free, it is a third party application. So it's better to create our own model instead of using a third party application, because we need to pay for it. So it's better to use our own model.
That Google OCR was giving you problems. If your OCR just for the payment thing, you are creating your own OCR model, which might not be as accurate as Google OCR, then your accuracy is going to decrease even more, right? That would be a problem.
We can try integrating the Google Cloud, Google Cloud Vision API with our data model, like for detecting which language is this, code of this. So,
got it. Now, you also had an indentation problem whereby I think the image had
in Python.
The image had indentation. Yeah. So, how do you solve that?
Generally, what I used to do in my school, when they used to teach us the Python, we used to add the brackets. So for indicating like these are the spaces. So we can actually create something like if you are adding the brackets, that means you are adding up the space. So we have to work on that. So generally, what our teacher used to say, you need to add the brackets in the startings for indicating that these are the spaces.
Okay, cool. That's it for the question tonight.
Cool. Any other questions from any other judges?
So which are the languages that you have been able to detect so far with the model?
C, C++, Python, and Java. We are also thinking to implement Ruby and Rails and etc. For this.
And also, detecting a language, right? They're just detecting, like, they're just selecting a text, and the language has to be selected manually. So, ideally, it can be expanded to any language which is supported by any online ID or something. But online ID are you using though for this?
We are using JDoodle API.
Which one?
JDoodle API.
Yeah. API. Okay.
Got it. So you get it from the OCR and pass it on to the JDoodle, and that compiles the old project.
Yeah. And for backend, we are using Firebase.
So that is just to store the past submissions.
For database. Yeah.
Got it. Makes sense.
The main motive of this application is that many slum children's, or even in our schools, like we used to write in handwritten code on paper. So we, in that time, we had a Geo phone or something like Nokia phone, which only have camera. That was not a smartphone. So that's why the people can access through website and
yeah. Most of our students don't have that amount of resources like laptop there, where they can code and all that stuff. So for those students, they can just click the code, click the picture of that code, and can just upload this on our website and can test it.
Yep.
Yeah.
The real life use application we have made. Yeah.
Makes sense. No, I don't have any other questions. So thanks.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for that presentation, guys, especially considering the fact that this was one of your first hackathon experiences. I'd say that was a job well done. Do look into how to improve the OCR mechanism later on. I think it'll be a good learning experience for you folks as well.
Right. And I guess one more quick addition I would like to add is ideally you can do most of the things you're doing as of now completely offline as an app. Because OCR to some degree can be done offline if you have your own model, but yeah, that's another concern. But at least the compilation and running part, those can be done within the app, so you can also
We will look into that for sure.
Nice suggestion.
Amazing, then we'll catch you later. If you just click the leave button on the top right of your screens. See you guys.
Thank you.
Cool. That brings us to the last team that we have for Hackouts top 10 presentations, and we'll just bring them on board. This is Team Vagmi. We are all gonna make it. And hey, they are Hitesh and Meet. How are you guys doing?
Okay, great. Yeah, nice to be a part of Hackout again.
Amazing. Cool.
Love the name.
Sorry,
I said love the name.
Thank you.
Yep, thanks.
Nice to meet you, Meet.
Oh, pun game strong.
cool. Cool then. You folks can just share your screen. I'll put it on, and then you can take it away.
Sure, Hitesh will go on. Thanks.
I hope the screen is visible now.
Yeah, it's visible now. I'll drop off. All the best, guys.
Cool. So let's start. Yeah, so our product is named Velocity. Velocity is basically a vector quantity, and we believe the success is also a vector quantity. It requires hard work, but it also requires direction. So that's the point. And it's basically an edtech platform which helps the creators to build courses and blogs and a lot of tools which are especially related to the programming stuff, the content creation, basically blogs, tutorials, and courses. We have specifically worked on courses part as a part of this hackathon. So the idea came because I'm already working in an edtech company from past 1.5 years, and I've been closely following what people are doing in this domain. So I feel there's a lot of courses in which people are using Excalibur and this is an example of Kenzie Dodd saying it was how using Excalibur made his life easier. He's also included this embed block, this code block, and similarly Excalibur diagram inside his recent blog. One more, Dan Ivanov is also a good follower of that project, and he has also recently used the things in his tool. So our idea was to build a tool which restricts, which enables creators to create such type of content without any friction. And usually these kind of websites, they heavily invest on the infrastructure as well. The creation part is also quite custom. So basically we wanted to create an experience which helps the creators to build that, but the focus should only on the content. The rest, the tools part will handle. So that's the philosophy behind it. So we are trying to build as much as possible. So So this is landing page, a basic landing page, and login. Once the user logs in, currently like we've not added permissions and all those things. If you're behind the authorization, you can see all the courses which are currently available on the platform. So in future, we are thinking of adding permissions and all like similar to Notion. So we'll take an example, the WAGMI course. So basically the core of this editor is basically the what you see and what you is what you get type of authoring experience. The world is moving towards that. The no code tools are coming. Notion is pretty popular already. One main reason is the traditional LMSs and also the content management systems. What they do is they provide a separate window for creation and separate for previewing. So you, the creator is directly not interacting with what the thing is being created. Notion in that sense is very powerful because it allows the creators to directly build what the users will see. So with that philosophy, we are also creating an experience. And for the editor part, we have used a prose mirror library. So basically, it provides us the building blocks, the the history, undo, all those parts. There's a lot of menus we can construct, like we can add a lot of formatting links and all those things. So, and what we have done is we have exploited a particular part of this library, which is the node views part, which helps us to create interactive views, and we have rendered them in React basically. So what users can do is, we have done is focus on two main blocks currently. Like one is the Xcalator, because we think like it's a lot easier to, if you are like directly building here and the creator can directly, learner can come here and directly see. Another thing is like good embeds. Embeds should be like easily parsed. So like if you just enter a YouTube link inside the embed block, it will generate something like this and you can directly view the video itself here. Similarly for the Figma, and we can have a lot of like Miro and all the popular tools we can support with like a little lines of code of basically it's a regex we have to replace to add more support. Then there is a real-time collaboration which is powered by WebRTC. Basically once the user is logged in and on the screen, they are already on the joined on the audio channel. So if they give audio permission, then we can talk here as well. Then we have provided the CRDT. We have used YJS. It's a very popular library. So it helps us to like manage the race conditions, and if there are a lot of users can come here. So I guess here's someone, Meet or someone else who is currently opening this course, and I can see what he's adding. So it helps solve the resolution code conflicts. Another important, very important part is the code execution block. So basically what we have observed is traditionally people, what they do is create a code sandbox or a code pen or a repl.it. So what it does is it creates a background process on the server, and it basically streams the inputs and output over the network. So it basically makes the thing very challenging if we have to scale that product, and also a lot of resource heavy. So if currently 1,000 users are visiting this website and executing, there are 1,000 Python processes running parallelly on somewhere on my server. So we have tried to solve it. I'm closely following this WebAssembly part of the thing. So I noticed like we can now compile a lot of languages to WebAssembly, and we can execute them in the browser itself. So for now, we have used a PyWrite wrapper. It helps us to execute the Python code on the browser itself. So basically, no request to server or server instances instantiated. A lot of libraries we can also import directly here itself. So as you can see, like I'll dynamically change the code. Now B is greater, so I'll see the output is this, and it's all running in the browser itself. So like that's the broad idea. And like this is a course type of structure, but we can also like the core engine is the editor. We can create blogs out of it, and we can create a lot of constructs using this thing. Apart from that, we have also tried to add a question generation block. So what it does is basically it extracts all the text content on the current page, and it sends to our Flask API we have developed, and it generates a MCQ type of question. So the inspiration is that a lot of programming courses, or in general Coursera edX courses, what they do is they add a knowledge check at the end of every course. So we, our idea was, what if we can like suggest the creator, like, this is the content, and for a knowledge check, these are the questions. So it is like not very well implemented right now, but basically it works a little bit. Like, I've added embeds explanation above, so it created like, what is the name of video games allows embeds. So it's not very perfect as of now, and also because the content is not very text heavy as for this page, for like a lot of paragraphs and text factual content, it generates quite good questions. So that's a good thing. That was the inspiration. So it's real time, and all this, like, I guess I've covered all most of the features. So I'll cover the what are the challenges we face. So first of all, the text editor itself is a very complex tool. A lot of DOM events are happening parallelly. There's a lot of API which has been exposed by ProseMirror, but the constructs it exposes a lot. Like, there's a construct of schema, there's a thing called node, there are some called extensions, because thing is pluggable, and you just have to remove it from array to remove a block from the whole editor. So it's very pluggable, but there are a lot of constructs. So yeah, so this real-time collaboration part was pretty straightforward for normal text, but for a tool like this Excalidraw, what we have to like dig deeper into the API, what kind of format it basically spins out, and how can we make it collaborative? And it is collaborative as of now. If someone else on this page makes a rectangle or something here, so I'll see it immediately. The another part was the code execution block. So it is kind of new thing, I guess. Not very new.
I interject, since you said it's collaborative, can you share the link, and can I test it out right now?
Yeah, definitely. I guess
share the link. In this chat itself, people can test it out.
Sure. So I'll like, for real-time collaboration, you have to have a, like, you have to log in once. I'll share the link.
Can I share the link in which audio?
Yeah, my friend has already shared. You can, like, I guess, come there already. But yeah, you can see it is here. One more thing is, like, we've also added the audio support, so that it would be great if we can mute it for now, because multiple voice channels will create echo in the system. Yeah. I guess if you're not logged in, you won't be able to edit as of now, but you will still be able to see my cursor. If you want to edit, you just have to go to the home page once and log in into the Google account. Then you can see, like, as Meeth is typing, and I'm also typing in between. Conflicts are pretty well handled. Meeth, can you like draw something near this trigger rectangle block, so that others can see the drawing part is also collaborative?
Just a second, it is loading for me. Can you see the square moving?
So for the people who have not logged in, the names will be random as of now. We're just selecting random number out of name out of array of 10. So yeah, another thing challenge was the race against time. We have a lot of things we have planned as of now, but like, we have to like prioritize the stuff, and we are definitely thinking of launching it. Like, we have to polish it a lot. We have just connecting a lot of pieces right as of now, but we have to like polish the course dashboard page and this experience as well. After that, like, we are like actually launching, because a lot of overhead is not like a lot of resources, I guess, we won't be consuming because the audio chat is also using WebRTC. We are not making it centralized as of now, because limited support can be, like, we can add, I guess.
Sorry, I just changed the flow chart that you have right now on your screen. I just changed it. It's not reflecting.
Where did you, like, it's a quite a big chart, I guess.
I'm changing the trigger AWS lambda function thingy. I've removed the square from that. Okay. I just moved the text you created a circle that
this is just an escalator embed, right? By the way,
okay, now it reverted all my changes to you. I can see your circle and diamond come in, but my changes that I just did, so my changes that I just did on your stuff didn't get reflected, but anything that you are creating is coming up over here. Okay, so what I created also came up. Can you the diamond that I just created, can you move that?
Definitely. So I'll keep it over there. So basically, currently it's not very, like, it's not delta specific. It is overwriting all of the editor content. And that's why it is like a little bit laggy as of now. But in future, we are thinking like as of rest of the content, it does not like copy pastes or like, your changes are live now, I guess, but it took a little while. This is because the content is a lot already on this box, and basically we are overwriting every time there's a change. So there's a lag, so we have to optimize it by only transferring the deltas, not the entire document. So that's I guess.
There should be some queuing mechanism that can, I think that should be able to solve this problem. Yes.
Yeah. Queuing can help. Basically, we can implement a general version of CRDT, which we can provide timestamp with versions, and the later version gets overwritten, something like that. Sort, I guess. Because the text part is a lot tricky because at one particular position, so basically suppose this O is at 120th position, there can only be single character at that position. But since it's a draw-based tool, it's a canvas-based tool, there can be a lot of elements on the same position. So I guess that would not be very challenging if we see the implementation of other CRDTs. Text part is like a little more...
Maybe I missed it, but I'm just asking again. Like, so if you have to like insert a particular type of snippet, right? You have to insert an escalate draw type of snippet. Yeah. Is there a slash command for that, or like how are you inserting it?
Yeah. So we are planning to have a slash command, but it requires a
right now it's like this. Okay. Yeah. Got it.
Just
yeah. Sure.
Because like Coda, we have explored Coda Notion. A lot of people are using slash based things, so I guess that's more intuitive as of today. So
we'll right.
On that.
Yeah, but it's fine. Like I'm just asking you to see if that happens. It's cool. Like I guess the implementation is good enough. That's all the questions for me at least. Like.
Do any other users have any questions? By the way, Hitesh, Meet, are you done with your presentation?
So basically we thought of like creating our presentation ourselves on our platform itself. So I guess we have covered almost all of it. If you have some questions, yeah, that would be like good to have some conversation around. Do you want to add anything?
No, I think you have covered a lot of the ground here.
Cool. I guess that's all the questions that we have. Again, it was a cool presentation, cool team name. Everything about you guys sounds pretty cool.
Really like the product as well. Like,
Wagmi, Yagmi.
Yeah. Yagmi. Cool. nicely done. Cool, then we'll catch you folks later in our Discord server.
Experience again. Cool. Thanks a lot for organizing such a great event.
Yeah, our pleasure. Cool.
Thanks a lot.
Bye bye. That brings us to the end of all of our presentations for Hackout 2021. A pretty bittersweet ending, I must say. Not really able to process the fact that it got over so quickly. It feels like it just started. But in any case, it has been a great experience for all of us, organizers, mentors, judges who have been working towards this event for the past couple of months. And then we got to see all of these amazing hacks, amazing folks who came up and participated, and totally made our day. We'll be declaring the results soon in the Discord server. And for sure, Yogesh, the last 48 hours were unreal. Hope you folks had as much fun attending the hackathon as we had organizing it. There are a lot of people who worked really hard for this. Won't take any names because I'm sure I'll miss out on some of them, but we'll definitely write a thank you message in Discord. Watch out for that. We'll also be declaring the results soon. I guess that's it from my end. Any other last words from any of our judges before we sign off?
I can always throw in some words. I haven't really like thought of anything, but yeah, like it was so much fun to organize Hackout. As it's always, Hackout has always been sort of like a hack for us too, because we also hack along the way for organizing things, for thinking through what all ideas we can put in, for thinking through, you know, what all events we can have, trying to have community engagement, trying to actually build hacks even ourselves. We have also been trying to build a decentralized currency for the Hackout community and Hackcats and stuff. These things will also go live in time. We just didn't find enough time for ourselves to be absolutely sure that everything is production ready, because this needs to be production ready. Can't be here this long test. But have had really good fun this time. It was so nice to see so many good presentations out there. People just working out, have put in night outs along with us, really had fun. Expecting to see you folks and many other folks next year. Next year will be even more things that you will do. And for whomsoever the winners will be, congratulations. For whomsoever haven't been able to come up in the winning course, you are also winners. You have been working with us to create such beautiful things alongside. So yeah, congratulations to everyone and happy Diwali in advance.
Yeah, nicely done, Vikram. Cool folks, I guess that's it from Hackout this year. We'll see you again next year with an even bigger and better hackathon. Hope you guys continue learning, continue hacking, continue building. And yeah, we'll catch you later. Bye-bye.